So we're talking about the purpose of church, and just to do a quick recap on last week, we talked about, you know, why do we gather as a church? And I sort of springboarded off this verse in 1 Timothy 3. It says, "These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth." And I'm sort of covering 4 points. You know, the first one was how we ought to behave ourselves in the house of God. So it's meant to provide a godly atmosphere where we can come. You know, it's not fornication, immodest dress, and, you know, all this sort of stuff in the house of God, because we have children here. And we want to set an example for our children, how to behave, how to act, how we should dress, how we should talk, all that sort of stuff. So we want to keep that in mind, that we want to provide a godly atmosphere in our church here. And it says here that how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God. So we want to be a family to one another and treat each other like family. You know, treat the older as fathers, the elder women as mothers, the younger brethren as brothers and sisters, in all purity. You know, so if you're trying to fornicate with another girl in the church, obviously you are not treating her as you should, as a sister in Christ, in all purity. The house of God, which is the church of the living God, which is what we're talking about, the pillar and ground of the truth. So there's 2 points there, I feel. One is the pillar of truth, where we uphold the truth, and we talked about a couple of the positions that we have. You know, one thing I just want to mention there before I talk about the ground of truth today. So the pillar is something that exalts the truth and holds it up. And when you come to church, this is where you should hear the truth. This is where the truth should be exalted. And if you come here as a zealous Bible-believing Christian, it's somewhere that you should feel normal. Now, one thing I forgot to mention last week is, I just want to mention, you know, because this is someplace that you come and you feel normal, you know, one thing I believe that God wants us to do is to, you know, have a lot of children, you know, be fruitful and multiply, but also, you know, that this would be a place that would, you know, welcome children into the gathering. So when I think about that, I just want to let you guys know that, you know, because we love children, we want children to be part of the gathering, that you should feel normal wanting your children to be in this gathering. And I just want to say it again, because it seems like it doesn't matter how many times I tell you guys that you don't believe me, you know, that if, you know, when we have children in this gathering here and they make noise, to be honest, it doesn't bother me at all. Like, you know, when we're praying and you have to get up and make noise, we're praying and the kids make noise, you know, you need to go upstairs, you need to take them over there, and there's noise, to be honest, I don't even blink an eye. It doesn't bother me at all, because, you know, it just reminds me to thank God that we have our children here to be part of this gathering. So, you know, in the house of God, it should be normal for you to have your kids in the service, not feel condemned or, you know, that people don't want them there. It should be the people that don't want them there. They're the people that should feel awkward in the house of God, because we want the children to be part of this. So, you know, the people that are complaining that it's distracting, or, you know, blah, they're making too much noise, well, then they're the people that need to sit at the back or sit at the front or whatever and get away from the kids and you know, I guess mature a little and suffer the little children, because they're the adult. You know, the children shouldn't cater for the adult. The adults should cater for the children so that they can be here and learn and be under the preaching and be part of this gathering. You know, another thing is, you know, if you need to spank your children, you know, the house of God should be somewhere where that is welcome, that's normal. You know, the world will condemn you. You know, if you go to the shopping center, yeah, you may feel weird if the world doesn't want you to spank your kids. But in the house of God, in this population, in this gathering, you shouldn't feel weird at all. And I understand, you know, with children, you know, I feel the same too. I'm often not as strict with my children when I'm out in public or at somebody else's house or even at church. But, you know, sometimes you guys have seen me take Simon or Timothy upstairs to give them a spanking, because I want you to know that, you know, if you need to take them upstairs and give them a spanking, you know, I'm not going to think you're a bad parent. In fact, I'm going to think you're a good parent, and I'm going to thank God that they have a parent that loves them enough that even though they're amongst other people and strangers, people they don't know that well, that they're still going to get what they need. They're still going to get that spanking and that love that they need to put them in line. And, you know, oftentimes it's when they're around other children, right, that they play up. So sometimes that's the time that you need to spank them, because that's the time they're being naughty. So that's why, you know, we have the stick in that bathroom and we have the stick in the room upstairs, because if you need to take them there and you know, give them a spanking, that's absolutely fine to do. And I won't even bat an eye. I don't care at all. So those sort of things should be normal in the house of God. And you should come here and feel comfortable, feel that you're supported in your parenting, feel that you're supported to have your children here and to sit. And you definitely have my support from the pulpit. But what I want to touch on today, hopefully I don't preach too far into lunch, but I want to talk about this last point, the ground of the truth. So we talked about the pillar of truth being a place where the truth is upheld, the truth is exalted. Now, how does that differ to the ground of truth? Now, when I think of the ground of truth, let's just go to 1 Corinthians 3, where I was before. First Corinthians 3, I just want to read this passage here. But, you know, when I think of the ground of truth, the way I think of it is, you know, it's like a garden. You know what I mean? The ground is meant to be like the soil and the atmosphere in which people can grow. And if you think about a garden, you know, you can do as much as you can to try and make these seedlings grow, but at the end of the day, it's God that makes that seed grow, isn't it? You can't force a seed to grow, but what you can do is you can provide an environment, you can provide an atmosphere that is most conducive for that seed to grow. So, you know, you'll tend to the garden, you'll water it, you know, you'll make sure that the temperature's right. If you need to put it in a greenhouse, you do. So that's where I think of the church being the ground of truth, is it's like the soil that we're all planted in. And if we have, you know, like what we talked about, the godly atmosphere, we exalt the truth, we're a family, we'll provide a soil and a garden in which people can flourish and then they can grow. So let's read here in 1 Corinthians 3, verse 6. It says, I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So people sometimes will take this verse too far and say, God just does everything. No, because God doesn't do everything. It's because it's just like a garden, right? We think about a garden. You know, yes, God ultimately makes that seed grow, but we have a responsibility to tend to that garden, to make sure that that garden has the right environment and all the things I just talked about. So we do play a part, but ultimately God does give the increase. But, you know, he says here that he has to plant and Apollos has to water. God gives the increase. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. So ultimately, like Jesus says, I think in John 15, without me, you can do nothing. So without God, none of the planting and watering makes any difference. But we still have a responsibility to do that. And every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. So there's that working together. We are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. So this is talking about the judgment seat of Christ. And, you know, there's different ways you can build upon the foundation of Jesus Christ, which is your salvation. You can say gold, silver, precious stones, verse 12, wood, hay, and stubble. So if you're wondering what can be gold, silver, and precious stones, and what can be wood, hay, and stubble, well, you think about what has eternal value and what doesn't. If it's not something that has eternal value, that's going to give you something in the next life, then that's wood, hay, and stubble. And every person is responsible how he's going to build his foundation. Now, we see here also that in verse 15, he says, if any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. A loss of what? A loss of reward. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. So this is supporting the fact that salvation is not by works, because your foundation is Jesus Christ. You get that foundation by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. But you can build on that foundation, gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, and stubble. And even though you've built a house fully of wood, hay, and stubble. Even if that all goes, you'll suffer loss. But the Bible says here, you'll suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire, showing that salvation is indeed by grace and not by works. So a couple of things I just want to mention here is, you know, it says here that God gives the increase. So the idea of church is not to force you to do good works. Yes, we do provoke unto love and good works, and we'll go to that verse in a second. But we cannot force good works. I mean, even if you force good works, it's not going to be good works. Because if the person is doing the good works because you force them to do it, they're not even doing it for the right reason. You know, because we have to do things in faith. And if people are just doing things to serve man, then that is not good works, because you're serving man, you're in sin. So, you know, we want to provide an environment in church where, not where we force people to grow and force people to do good works, because that's not the sort of growth we want. We want people to do it for the right reasons. We want people to do good works because they love God. And when we think about that, if that's what church is meant to be, that's how we want to provoke unto love and good works. You know, we don't provoke unto love and good works by guilting people, making people feel bad, but we might provoke unto love and good works by saying, hey, you know, if you love God, don't you love God enough to want to go soul-winning? You know, don't you love people enough to want to go tell them about Jesus? You know, don't you want to grow as a Christian? Because if you do not get involved in the work, you don't witness, you're not going to grow. Jesus said, you know, that the branch that tries to bear fruit, he's going to purge it, that it may bring forth more fruit. So as a Christian, you know, if you are honestly, seriously wanting to grow as a Christian, you're going to want to do good works. So if you love God and you want to grow, do good works. But don't do good works because you're worried about what man thinks, or you're worried about what you know, that you're being guilted into it by another person. Now, the only reason why you should care about what other people think is because you want to be an example, right? You want to be an example to other people. So there, you know, there's a balance here of the right way to do things and the wrong way to do things. But if we have the right purpose of what the church should, how the church should do it, how it should be a ground, that will change how we think about how we are to encourage one another in the Lord and how we are to talk to one another. Because we don't want to hinder that growth, you know, and we want people to be able to grow freely in the Lord and just, you know, be in good ground like we're talking about. So, you know, we don't need to force good works. And in fact, you know, we can't, because we'll only create believers that are serving man. So we don't want people to be serving man, serving out of fear. We want people to be serving out of love, and first and foremost, love for God. But we also see here, it says, let every man, verse 10, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder. Paul is saying, I have laid the foundation. So what does he mean here? He's preached unto them the gospel. He's got them saved. So that foundation is Jesus Christ. And he says, another buildeth thereon. So other people are helping you to build this house, right? But look at what it says in verse 10, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon, right? So there's this idea here that even though, you know, the church is this ground of truth that you're going to be planted in, that's going to help you to grow, ultimately you are responsible for your own spiritual growth. You are responsible for where you are right now in the Lord and how spiritually mature you are. You can't say, well, you know, nobody helped me, or nobody taught me this, or my church wasn't helping me to grow. You can't really blame it on anyone else. You are responsible for your own spiritual growth, so you need to take it upon yourself to get in the Word. You know, like, you can't say, well, you know, church only meets one time a week, that's not enough for me to grow in the Lord. But you got to be reading the Bible every day. I mean, you're just coming here for a meal that I've prepared, but you got to feed yourself every day. And to be honest, that's the only way you're going to grow. If you think church is, you know, the only thing that's going to make you grow, you've got it wrong. It's here to support your growth. It's here to support you in raising your family. But you ultimately are going to be responsible to make sure you implement the commandments of God to make sure you and your family are growing. So you've got a responsibility there. I'm going to show you this verse in Psalm 92. I thought it was... I came across it and I thought it fit really well with this thought of church being a ground of truth and like this soil in a garden. It says here in Psalm 92:12, the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. Now, we just have to be careful. Like, every time we read passages in the Old Testament, we need to interpret them in light of the New Testament and the New Covenant. So it talks about, you know, the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. And we might think, oh man, I still sin, I'm not righteous, right? So we can't misapply that and just say those that are perfectly righteous will flourish, because we are righteous by faith. So in the Old Testament, you know, it talks about the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree, but we know our righteousness is of God by faith. So those that believe are the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like the cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. And see, the house of the Lord in the New Testament is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. So we can see there that if we are planted, you know, because obviously we're not perfect too, so the house of the Lord is not a perfect house, because we're all made of sinners. But we see that principle there, that if we have a church that is striving to try and do the right thing, trying to provide that environment, and the righteous believer by faith is planted in that house, that will help them to flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. A cedar is a very large tree. So that's how the church, that's how I see the church work. That's why, you know, it's called the ground of truth. And you know, your heart works the same way. You know, we think about the parable of the sower. You know, we had the seed that fell by the wayside, we had the stony ground, the thorny ground, but then the good ground. So just like the believer being planted in this good ground will bring forth fruit in his old age, it's the same as your heart. You know, if you let the seed of God, the word of truth, be planted and your heart is good ground, you will also bring forth fruit as a believer. So it's a consistent analogy in the word of God of this, I guess, this husbandry, this farm, right? Or this garden that is being tended to, and the house of God is like this garden, this ground of truth where believers can flourish and grow in the Lord. Okay, so Hebrews 10. You know, so part of being a ground of truth and an environment for people to flourish is a place where we provoke unto love and good works. Hebrews 10, 24. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. So the Bible here is very clear. Well, God is very clear here that he wants us to be in church, and he wants us to provoke one another into love and good works. And that's part of, you know, providing this environment of this ground of truth where we are provoking one another unto love and good works. But one thing I just want to touch on in this passage, you know, verse 25 says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. So this verse really is the key verse that people use to exhort you to be in church, to say, hey, don't forsake the assembly. Make sure you are planted in the house of God so that you can flourish like we read in Psalm 92. But then the question arises is, well, then how often should I go to church? How often should I go to church until I am forsaking the assembly? Well, you know, number one, if you're not going to church at all, obviously you've forsaken the assembly. You know, if you say, I don't want to be in church, that is forsaking the assembly, because you are not even trying to get into the assembly of God. And, you know, you have to be like a seed. A seed has to be planted in the ground first before it can even grow. So, you know, it's a good idea for us to be planted in a house of God somewhere so that we can really promote the growth of that seed. It's funny that, you know, some seeds don't need the ground to grow in. You know, you put seed in a cup of water and it'll start to sprout and start to grow. So, you know, I think you can take that analogy and you can say, well, you know, you will be better in ground to grow. But, you know, if you're not in ground, you can still grow. You could still, you know, read the Bible yourself and listen to sermons online and grow as a Christian, but you won't grow as good as you would if you're in a church. So then the question arises, well, how many times should you go to church? So I'm not forsaking the assembly, but how often should I go to church where I'm not forsaking the assembly? And, you know, questions like this, you know, really, you know, can reveal somebody's heart. But also, you know, there's a couple of principles in the Word of God where we can use to answer questions like this. And the two that I think of are, you know, number one in Romans, where it talks about, you know, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. And then in James, where it says, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. So there's a bit of self-analysis there where, you know, the Bible says if you whatsoever is not of faith is sin, it means if you don't believe it's right to do, then it's sin. And James is saying if you know to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. It's saying if you think you should be doing something and you don't do it, then it's sin. But, you know, this is a relative measure because, you know, what I think is good to do may not be what you think is good to do or what I believe something is right. And these are gray areas. I'm not talking about clear areas like salvation or whatever. These are what the Bible calls doubtful disputations. So it might be dress. It might be, you know, the length of your hair. It might be what colors you feel are girly or manly. You know, I honestly think, you know, pink shirts and things like that are girly. But to say that the color pink is girly, that's just a conviction I have. It's not something the Bible actually says because the Bible doesn't say that pink is girly. So, you know, there are things like this where we have this principle of, you know, how we can judge things like that. So how often should we go to church is really the question. You know, because let's say a person goes to church once a week. Are they forsaking the assembly? You know, we have church once a week here, so you'll feel that, you know, you're not forsaking the assembly because you're going to every church gathering that we have. But let's say you went once a month. Are you forsaking the assembly? Because you haven't forsaken the assembly, you're just not going as often as anyone else. Well, how we could judge that is, well, if you think that you're not doing the right thing by missing church, then you are in sin. So if you can, in good conscience, miss church every second week, and you're okay with that, then yeah, okay, I can say, well, maybe you're not sinning, maybe you're not doing, you're not necessarily doing wrong. Or if you, you know, if you think you should be going to church, like, you know, you're going twice a week and you wake up on Sunday, you say, you know what, I really should be there, I need the preaching, I need the fellowship, and you don't go, then you are in sin. Because to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. But does the Bible say that you must go to church every week? No, it doesn't. It just doesn't. It just says, don't forsake the assembling of ourselves together. Well, then you say, well, but if you're not, if church is on and you're not there, aren't you forsaking the assembling of yourselves together? So aren't you in sin then? Because church is happening and you're not there. Well, the reason why I don't hold to that position is because what if church meets multiple times a week? You know, like what if you work on a Wednesday night or on a Sunday morning and you can't make it? You know, are you sinning? Should a person quit their job in order to make it to church? I don't think they're in sin if they work during church. I think, you know, I would definitely encourage, you know, if you want to be part of our church, you know, you're going to have to not work Sundays because otherwise you can't be part of this church, right? So, you know, there's an element there that if you want to be part of this church, then you probably would want to, you know, leave your job in order to make it. But it's not a sin to work during church. So what was the point? Sorry, I'm sort of mixing myself up in my head. I hope I'm making myself clear. But, you know, you say, well, what if you were to skip one Sunday? Are you in sin? Well, what if a church had multiple gatherings a week? How many of those per week would you have to go to make sure that you're not forsaking the assembly? So you see how, like, if we make a rule where you have to make it go to every gathering, which is not what the Bible says, it just says don't forsake the assembly. But if you make a man-made rule and say, well, you have to make it to every gathering, what happens when a church has four or five gatherings a week? You know, some churches do. They have Wednesday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and then sometimes they'll have, like, a Tuesday night prayer meeting, and then they have, like, the Saturday night social event, to the point where you're just, like, living there. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. I'm not condemning those people. But then it's just... what I'm getting at is some people don't have the schedule to be able even to do that. But then are they in sin just because they're not at every single church gathering? You know, maybe a single person without young children can do that. But my point is we just want to be able to differentiate what's a man-made rule, which is you need to be at every church gathering, and what the Bible actually says, which is don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. So if you're not going to church at all, I think we can clearly say you are in sin. But how many times you go to church, I think that's something between you and God and between your conscience, whether you are in church as much as you can be. And really, the Bible says, you know, everything we do to the glory of God. So we should be striving for the maximum. I mean, if you have a heart that is saying, what's the least amount of church I can go to until I'm right with God? I mean, you've got the wrong frame of mind. You should be thinking, how often can I go? What's the most I can do? And I think that's a heart that pleases God. But you know, why did we only choose to have a weekly meeting? I just want to give you my reasoning, just if you're wondering, you know, because we come from a tradition in a lot of churches where, you know, you have the Wednesday night, the Sunday morning, and the Sunday night. And some of you might be wondering, well, why did we only choose to have the Sunday morning and not the three gatherings a week? Well, my reasoning behind that, when we think of Wednesday, you know, we used to go to Lighthouse Baptist Church over in La Perouse, and when we were living over there, it was fine because I worked in Mascot and then, you know, just go home, you know, 10-minute trip, you know, have time for dinner and then head over to church at 7:15, I think it started. But a lot of people couldn't make it to the Wednesday night because a lot of people live out west. So, and when I moved here to Punchbowl, it was like, you know, 40 minutes home, I have to like eat in like 10 minutes and then 40 minutes back over to church. And then you'd only just get there on time, and then you'd have to, you couldn't really stay really late because you'd have to get home and then get your kids to sleep. So it was almost like the amount of time you were traveling and getting ready to go to church, that was the amount of time you were actually at church. And then because, you know, there wasn't really time for fellowship afterwards, I guess it depends how close you live to your church, you know, people would shoot off straight after church because, you know, you'd finish at like 8:30 and, you know, people got like an hour trip home that they have to get back over west. So I just felt it wasn't really conducive for fellowship, and it just wasn't really worth the time it took to travel and to prepare for that night for the time that you were actually together. And it was quite stressful for, you know, my family because it's young. And, you know, obviously this is just my experience. So if you have an experience where you said, hey, you know, I didn't feel that way, then, you know, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with Wednesday night, just giving you a bit of reasoning why we did it the way we did it here. So that's why we didn't have the Wednesday. I just felt like it was a bit and because I'm working full time, it was just a bit too much. So we didn't do the Wednesday because we just thought, you know, it was only a little bit of time together and it was a lot more work for that. Now the Sunday night we didn't decide to do because it just made Sunday way too long because we, you know, we started in the morning and then we wanted to have soul winning on Sunday. So yeah, if you're the sort of Christian that just goes to church twice on Sunday, but you don't go soul winning, yeah, Sundays is great, right? Because you're not doing the preaching, you're not involved in the service, you know, you just go there, you're just watching two gatherings and then you go home. Yeah, that's really relaxing. But when you're the one actually preparing it, you're the one preaching the sermons, you're the one preparing, you know, everything that's going on. And then, you know, you're preparing for the lunch and helping to pack up and set down and clean up, and then you're going soul winning Sunday afternoon. Having another gathering at night which just made the day so long. And then because it was normally around 6 o'clock, if you went soul winning, you didn't eat dinner until like 8:30, you know, because there was not much time to eat dinner before because you'd come back from soul winning and it's time to go to church for the evening gathering. So it just made the day, in my opinion, way too long. It was really tiring for my wife as well with the kids. So the way I thought about it in my head is, instead of separating up three smaller gatherings, why didn't we just have the one big gathering on Sunday? So that's why, you know, we sort of emphasize our Sunday morning gathering and want everyone there. And I think it works really well. And that's why we have prayer on Sunday morning, so that we don't have the Wednesday night prayer meeting. We come together on Sunday and we pray. And, you know, we pray and we have, you know, a good meaty doctrinal message. You know, we eat together. So I thought it would work better if we just emphasize this one big gathering weekly rather than three more stressful gatherings throughout the week. And I think it's working pretty well. I hope you guys like how we do it here. I know we definitely like it better. It's just, you know, something to look forward to, and then you have a bit more of a relaxing night. And that's also the reason why we start at 9 o'clock, you know, because people say, oh, you know, you start really late. Because we want to start at 9 o'clock so that we have time for prayer, we have time for Bible reading, but also so we had time to prepare lunch. Because one thing I didn't like about a lot of churches is that when church is going on and the preaching and the singing and the teaching are going on, you got all the ladies like off in another room having to prepare lunch for everyone because everyone wants to just walk out of the service and be served, right? Walk out of the service and it's like, oh, how come lunch is not ready? Well, you know, because people have that mentality, and you shouldn't have that sort of mentality, you know, because, you know, you're not here to be served, you're here to serve. You know, I didn't want people to miss out on church because I have to prepare food for everyone. So that's why I started it earlier, so that we have time for all these things, but we also have time to prepare lunch together and still eat at a good time. So that's a bit of my reasoning behind why we do it the way we do it. not just trying to be different. But, you know, why do churches traditionally meet on Sunday mornings? You say, well, you know, should a church meet on Sunday? Should they meet on Saturday? What if they only meet on Saturday nights or on Sunday? Are they sinning? Well, no, actually, because it's just really tradition why we meet on Sunday mornings. We're not even commanded how often to meet. You know, who knows if they met every 2 weeks or weekly, or they met, you know, they met daily even. I mean, should we be meeting daily? But there's no commandment in the Bible telling us how often we are to meet. We see examples of the Bible of when they met. And that's really where we get the tradition of the Sunday morning gathering, because that is the day that Christ rose again from the dead. So that's when people remember and celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have examples in the Bible of the apostles and disciples breaking bread on the first day of the week. But it's not a sin if churches don't meet on a Sunday. Some churches meet on a Saturday night. Some churches meet on a weekday night, whenever it's convenient for them, because there isn't a command. But one thing I will say is, you know, that Sunday is not the new Sabbath, you know, which is what a lot of Protestant churches teach, that Sunday is the new Sabbath and it's a sin to work on Sunday. You know, the Sabbath has been done away with. We do not keep the Sabbath anymore. It was Saturday in the Old Testament. So the Sunday is not magically this new Sabbath, because Jesus Christ rose from the dead, which is what the, you know, Westminster Confession of Faith teaches. So I don't refer to Sunday as the Lord's Day, as a lot of churches teach, because we're not told in the Bible what day the Lord's Day is. And in fact, in Revelation, when John uses that phrase, the Lord's Day, he could be talking about the day of the Lord. And in fact, I believe that the day of the Lord is actually a long period of time. But I'll go into that in another sermon, or you can ask me about that. But that's what I think the Lord's Day is referring to, and that's why Revelation goes on into the end times and the things that are happening in the last days. So I don't refer to Sunday as the Lord's Day, as though this day is holier than other days, because every day is the Lord's Day. Every day is a day that we ought to worship and glorify God with our life. But, you know, according to our schedule and according to tradition, you know, we have the weekend on Saturdays and Sundays, so it's just easier for us to meet on Sundays. Okay, so that's, you know, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. The other thing I just want to touch on is, and it says here in verse 24, and let us consider one another to provoke unto love and good works. So what are different ways we can provoke each other unto love and good works? We already touched on it a bit already, but I just wanted to talk about a couple of verses. But one way we can provoke unto love and good works, we provoke unto love, is, you know, we follow the commandment that Jesus gave us to love one another. John 13, verse 34, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you. How did Jesus Christ love us? With an unconditional, sacrificial love. He, you know, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. He says, as I have loved you. So this is the sort of love we should have one for another, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one for another. So it's interesting there that, you know, often we think it's our doctrinal positions that make people know that we're disciples of Jesus Christ. But Jesus says, how will other people know that you're my disciples? He said, if you have love one for another, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if you have love one for another. So it's how we treat our church. It's how we treat one another. This is how the world is going to know that we are disciples of Jesus Christ. And, you know, we ought to love one another, you know, and I just want to say this on this point, you know, I have time for you guys, you know, like, I want to love you guys. I want to give you my time and give you my attention and things like that. So don't ever feel that you are taking up my time. You know, a lot of people, you know, when they come to me, they might ask me a question or they want to catch up, and they'll think, you know, they might have the frame of mind, oh, you know, Victor's so busy and things like that. And, you know, I am busy. We're all busy, right? Everyone's busy. But, you know, don't have the frame of mind that you're worried about taking up my time. Like, if you want to ask me a question, you know, you don't have to worry about, you know, taking up too much of my time. I'm here to give you my time. And this is why, you know, on Friday nights, you know, in my calendar, you can't see this, but I actually try and schedule to like have people over. I'm hoping to have you over on this coming Saturday, actually, Juan, so remind me later. But to have you guys over and to make time with you and have you over and talk with you and get to know you. And I want you guys to do the same with each other. You know, hey, have each other over and get to know one another. And don't feel that you're taking up my time or, you know, that you're inconveniencing me, because this is part of who we are, right? We want to give time for one another. I want to help you. If you want to get together with me and talk to me about something, then let me know and I'll book it in my calendar and we'll have you over for dinner, or you can have us over for dinner or whatever. So don't have that feeling. And in fact, if somebody wants to spend time with me and my family or with me talking about certain things, that's the person I want to spend time with, because I know that person's going to appreciate my time. That, you know, if somebody wants to meet with me, I mean, they're the person I want to meet with. You know, oftentimes in churches, the bishop is so busy meeting with people that don't even want to be met with. They're not even in church. You know, they're out, and you know, you have to sort of, you know, bug them to meet up with them. I mean, if I have people that want to meet up with me, that are in church and want to meet with me, those are the people I am going to focus on first, before I go and spend time with others, because I should love, you know, the Bible says do good to all men, especially those of the household of faith. So you first and foremost are the people I want to spend my time with and to help if you want my help. So that's why I do things the way I do, and I have the Fridays to have you guys over for dinner. If it doesn't work for you, we can work out another day. But don't ever feel like you're an inconvenience to me, or, you know, I don't have time for you. I have time for you guys. You know, I have time. And if not, I'll make time. So I'm going to show you this verse in Matthew 25, just on this issue of loving one another. we'll just read from verse 31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was an hungered, and ye gave me meat. I was thirsty, and ye gave me drink. I was a stranger, and ye took me in. Naked, and ye clothed me. I was sick, and ye visited me. I was in prison, and ye came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer, saying, Lord, when saw we thee an hungered, and fed thee, or thirsty, and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger, and took thee in, or naked, and clothed thee? Or when saw we thee sick, or in prison, and came unto thee? And the king shall answer, and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Then shall he say unto them on the left hand, Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was an hungered, and ye gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and ye gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and ye took me not in. Naked, and ye clothed me not. Sick, and in prison, and ye visited me not. Then shall they also answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee an hungered, and a thirst, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not minister unto thee? Then shall he answer them, saying, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of these, ye did it not to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Now, a lot of people have issue with Matthew 25 because they just think, oh, Matthew 25 just supports work salvation so much. And just remember, like what I talked about in Psalm 92, we have to understand Old Testament passages in light, or Old Covenant passages in light of the New Covenant. Because even though this passage is in the New Testament, what we call the New Testament scriptures in Matthew, it is still in the time of the Old Covenant, because the New Testament did not start until Jesus died and rose again. So he's still speaking in like these dark sort of parables and stories and referring to this works-based righteousness, because that's the Old Covenant. But we know under the New Covenant, the righteousness is by faith. So that's why when it says he separates the sheep and the goats and the righteous from the unrighteous, he's not separating us by our works, because otherwise we'd all be goats. He's separating us based on our faith, right? So that's the separation of the sheep and the goats. And the reason why he's saying that the righteous will be on the right and the left is because we have the righteousness by faith, and the goats are those that do not believe, that are not saved. But what I wanted to refer to here, it's interesting that he says, you know, when I was hungry and blah, 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 and all these things, and then the righteous shall answer, so, Lord, when saw we thee hungered and fed thee, or thirsty and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger and took thee in, or naked and clothed thee? Verse 40, and the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Now, this is a very profound passage, just because it shows that when we do things for the family of God, we are actually doing things for Jesus. Why is that? Well, because number one, remember, we're the body of Christ. So we're the body of Christ. So when we minister to Jesus physically, we don't minister to him because he's in heaven. We minister to his body. And that's why Jesus can say that, you know, we are doing it to him, even though we do it to the least of these my brethren. And isn't it interesting, verse 40, when he says, you do it unto my brethren. Remember last week we talked about being the family of God. And remember that passage that we went to where he says, hey, your mother, your brethren, your sisters stand without seeking to speak with thee. And he said, behold, you know, the people that do the will of my Father, these are my brother and my mother and my sisters. So there again, supporting the fact that we are the family of God, we are his brethren, we are his body. And that's why when you serve another brother or sister in Christ, you are not only serving that brother or sister in Christ, you are actually serving Jesus. Now that's I think that's really profound, because you know, you may like do something for somebody, and they may not necessarily like appreciate it, or may not, you know, whatever, but you still can take comfort in the fact that you are serving the Lord Jesus. And it gives you a different perspective on things. Because it's like with your job. If you realize that your job is a spiritual activity, because you need to work hard and you need to work and serve your boss as if you're serving Jesus, then it'll change your mentality at work. You don't just work hard when the boss is looking. You don't just work hard for money. You don't just work hard for recognition. You can work hard because you're serving the Lord Jesus, just like we do with the rest of our life. So it'll change how you treat one another. Because let's say somebody needs to move house and you want to help. Man, you're not just helping that person move house. You're helping Jesus move house. You know, if somebody needs, you know, help with something else. I mean, apply whatever situation you want. But it's just a very profound truth there that when we serve one another, that is actually the practical way that we minister to Jesus Christ, like he says here in Matthew 25. So there are a couple of things that we can take from this. I mean, because we're the body of Christ and because we serve Jesus by serving the body of Christ, it's just interesting that the body of Christ can actually be thought of as a way Jesus actually does work in this world, if that makes sense. Because if we serve Jesus, that's his body. When the body does things, we're doing things as though Jesus is doing it in the world. So the fact that believers are Christ's body, there's some implications to that. I mean, number one is, you know, Christ can bless through believers. So sometimes when you get help from another brother or sister in Christ, that is one way Christ is actually using his body to help you. Because sometimes people are too proud, I don't know, or they're too embarrassed, or for whatever reason, to receive help from another person. You know, I'll give you an example. Like, you know, somebody might need money, right? But then they're too embarrassed to receive money from another brother or sister in Christ, because they're like, oh, no, I don't take your money. I'm just going to trust God. But then this is how Christ is helping you. You know, that's why the church is to help the needy. This is Jesus is using men to carry out his will and to help somebody. So if somebody needs help, but yet they're too embarrassed or too proud to receive help from another person, that may be how Jesus Christ is helping you. You know, so Christ can bless through believers. You know, Christ can provide through believers. Christ can be served through believers. Christ can be served by believers, right? You know, Christ can speak through believers. You know, sometimes Jesus Christ will speak to you through his body. You know, Christ can be fellowshipped with through believers. So that's why we talk about, you know, if you love God, why would you not love being together with his people? But another thing, you know, Christ can be rejected through believers. That's why when we go and knock the doors and people reject us, they're not only rejecting you, they are rejecting the Lord Jesus Christ, because you are there as part of the body of Christ. So, you know, we're talking about provoking unto love and good works. So this is how we can, you know, we're meant to be a ground of love, right? Where we're provoking people unto love. Let's go here to Mark 10. So, verse 42, but Jesus called them to him and saith unto them, ye know that they which are accounted to rule over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. But so shall it not be among you, but whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister, and whosoever of you will be chiefest shall be servant of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. So we talked about provoking unto love. I mean, provoking unto, part of that, part of provoking unto love and good works is, you know, provoking us unto good works. I'm just going over a couple of things that are good works. So we talked about love, but service, you know, serving one another, you know, having this frame of mind that you are not here to be served, but you are here to serve. Jesus is saying here that the greatest or the chiefest among you shall be servant of all. And that's why, you know, I, as the bishop of this church, I strive to serve you. And I don't mind like being on the barbecue while you guys are fellowshipping and doing stuff and getting everything done, because, you know, I want to serve you guys. But, you know, I also don't want you guys to have the frame of mind that you're here to be served. You know, if everybody comes to church with the frame of mind to serve, that is a really good ground of truth and a ground that's going to provoke us unto love and good works. And it's the same in your marriage. You know, if you have a frame of mind where your wife is there to serve you or your husband's there to serve you, you're going to have a bad marriage. But if you have the frame of mind where both of you are trying to serve one another, that is one way you can have a really good marriage, because, you know, you don't get upset at each other. Because you're not upset at her because she didn't do something for you, because you're not there for her to serve you. You're there to serve her. And if you both have that frame of mind, man, that's how you can have a really good marriage. So because we should be served, you know, I do have an expectation for you guys to come here and to get involved. You know, I do have an expectation for you guys to help with the cooking, to help with the cleaning, to help with the pack up and the set down, to help with all that sort of stuff. So definitely expect you guys to help out during church. You know, I also expect you guys to get involved with the soul winning. You know, I'm never going to, you know, force you or make you feel bad for not going, because I understand everyone has different situations. Everyone's at different walks in their life. But yeah, I definitely expect everyone to strive to get to that point where they are involved in the soul winning. They are involved in the outreach and they are part of what we're doing here, because I want you to grow. You know, because if you, you know, maybe if you've been coming along this church and you're new here, everything's exciting, everything's fun. You know, we're a new church. So it's exciting just to be here and to just be a part of it. But I tell you what, like if you're going to this church week after week after week for months and months and years and you don't go soul winning, eventually this is not going to do much for you. You know, the fellowship is not going to do much for you, because you have to actually start doing the exercise. You know, you can take in all the spiritual food and the spiritual fellowship, but if you're not actually exercising it and working those spiritual muscles, you're not going to grow and get stronger in your faith. So that's a big reason why I want you guys to get involved in the soul winning, so that you'll grow, because you learn tons out soul winning. And yeah, there's just so many advantages that I won't go into right now. But come to church with an attitude of service, guys. You know, come here to serve. And what are some telltale signs of a person that comes to church with the attitude of being served? Well, here's a couple of things that people say. I've just got two examples, but you know, often people will go to church and they'll say like, oh, that church was not very friendly. You know, I went to that church, they weren't really friendly. They didn't invite me to this or that. They didn't, like, nobody came and said hello to me. You know, I got out of church and, you know, nobody's messaging me, nobody's texting me to see how I am. And, you know, and that's all fine. I think a church should do that. But somebody with that attitude, they're going to a church to be served. Because think about it, that's all, like, what is it? This church didn't do anything for me. Like, you know, I was out of church and nobody contacted me and nobody's friendly to me. But that's not the sort of attitude we should go with to church. We should go with an attitude to serve. So instead of thinking nobody was friendly to me, I should be going to church saying, hey, I'm going to be friendly to somebody today. I'm going to text somebody today. I'm going to message somebody today. I'm going to have somebody over for dinner today. You know, not, oh, you know, I went to this church, nobody invited me over for dinner. I'm inviting everyone else over for dinner, but I haven't been invited to dinner yet. You know, so this is how you can tell, you know, do you have the attitude when you come to church of service? Or do you have the attitude of being served? You know, it's like when people, you know, you get out of church at the end and people are like, oh, the food's not even ready yet. That shows that you've got an attitude of being served instead of, hey, the food's not ready yet. What can I do to help get it ready? So you see, by what you say is showing whether you're coming with the right attitude to church or not. It's the same when people, like, you know, saying hello. I guess it's the same topic. They'll say, like, oh, I went to church and nobody said hello to me. That shows that people are coming to church to be served. Because if you come to church to serve, you're going to be the one trying to say hello to people, you know, and say, hey, I want to come to church and I want to be a blessing to somebody today, as opposed to, I want to come to church and where's my blessing, right? So let's have the right frame of mind. And if we do, I think it'll provide a much better atmosphere in our church when it's a church of service. Let's look at a couple of other ways we can provoke unto love and good works. You know, prayer. You know, praying for one another. And, you know, to be honest, I really struggle with prayer. You know, I think prayer is the most spiritual thing you can do, because at least soul winning, there's like some results there. You know, you talk to people, you can see. But, you know, prayer is, you know, when you're basically leaving it all up to God and just saying, hey, God, you need to do this for me. You know, and prayer is a highly spiritual thing. It says here in James 5:16, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So, you know, we should pray one for another. And, you know, that's why I, you know, make the list available, and get the list if you don't have the list. You know, make sure your prayer requests are up to date, and pray one for another. You know, that's something that we should definitely be doing. Matthew 21:12-13. Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. And he said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. And this is always a point that always stuck with me, because nowadays the house of God is more known as a house of preaching, you know? But the Bible says that the house of God ought to be a house of prayer for all nations. That's what he wants it to be called. And that's part of the reason why I wanted prayer on Sunday mornings, because I didn't want this place to just be a house of food or a house of preaching. I want it to be a house of prayer as well. So definitely encourage you guys to try and make it along to 9 o'clock if you can, to be part of that prayer. Now, I don't know, this is not actually my notes, but I just wanted to see if I can, Philippians 1. You know, this is a interesting passage. I don't know if I have the right verse. Ah, okay, here. I just wanted to show you this. It wasn't in my notes, but I just think this is a really great point about prayer. To know that, you know, your prayers, you know, because we're talking about provoking unto love and good works, but see, your prayers actually make a difference to other people's spiritual walk. I mean, I don't know how God works that out, but we see here in Philippians 1 that Paul prayed for the Philippians, and he believed that because he prayed for them, he was confident that God was going to work in their life. Look, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making requests with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. So we just stop there. That's a very famous verse where people say, hey, you know, you're saved. Hey, God's going to work in your life. But I want you to see the context around this verse. So he's confident that Jesus Christ will work in their life. Verse 7, even as it is meet for me to think of this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, ye all are partakers of my grace. So isn't it interesting there that the reason why Paul was confident that that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. The context there is he's saying that I'm always in every prayer of mine for you all, making requests with joy. He's praying for his brethren. And not only that, in verse 7, he says, even as it is meet for me to think this of you all. He's saying it's suitable that I'm confident and thinking this of you all because I have you in my heart. So it's like he believes, and you know, I struggle with this too, but I'm just seeing this point here in the Word of God, that the reason why Paul was so confident that Christ was going to work in them, that Christ was going to work in the tribulation that they were experiencing, is because he was praying for them. And I just wanted to make this point here that, you know, if you pray for one another, that does make a difference to the spiritual walk of other people. Don't think that you're praying in vain. So provoking unto love and good works, we talked about love, we talked about, you know, having an attitude of service, praying one for another and the difference that that makes. You know, obviously the most obvious work that we can do is the soul winning. I won't turn to those verses, but you know, the Great Commission to go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature, you know, and that's why we have the soul winning program. That's why we have the organized soul winning. You know, that's why I put that map up on the wall there, because I want to show you guys how we're progressing. It's to provoke unto love and good works. And obviously as well, the Great Commission doesn't just involve just the witnessing, it's the teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And that's why we teach, you know, the scriptures, and we teach the commandments of God to provoke you unto love and good works, because if you don't know what to do, how can you be provoked unto love and good works? All right, let's just go to a couple more places. Just want to make a couple more points, but one is, you know, great things can happen in this church if we are all involved, right? If we are all involved, that's why we have that mind that we're all there to serve. Great things can happen, because if everyone here is expecting me to do great things, that we're not going to do as great things if it's all me and not everyone here is involved. And that, and in the Bible, great things were never done by just one person. Like we read about one person standing up and being the voice, but then the change actually happens is when everyone gets involved. I mean, Paul never traveled alone. Like there were always companions with him. We think of Paul as this one great man, but we forget often the people that traveled with him and the people that worked with him. And you know, even though I may be the leader, I may be the spokesperson of this church, we will be able to do much greater things if we all play our part. And this is what I think Romans 16 is about. I don't know if you guys have ever read Romans 16, but you know, you read Romans 16 and it's basically just a chapter of just random names. And I remember when I first learned about Romans 16 in a church that I first went to, it was sort of preached to me as though it was like, you know, Romans 16 was like the hall of just the no names kind of thing. It was just like, for some reason, it was just all these people that are mentioned, but we don't know why. But I think I know why they're all mentioned in Romans 16. And I think it's because God is trying to give us a chapter to show us everyone that was involved in the work in the Roman church. And also the companions of Paul, to show that he was not alone in his work, and we are never alone in the great things we do. We are all part of it. But let's read Romans 16 and just keep that in mind as we read through it, and you'll see just how much it is about supporting one another and getting involved in the work. I commend unto you Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church which is at Cenchrea, that ye receive her in the Lord as becometh saints, and that ye assist her in whatsoever business she hath need of you, for she hath been a succorer of many and of myself also. I think succor means to like support. I'm not 100% sure, but it's like you support somebody. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers. See, my helpers in Christ Jesus, who have for my life laid down their own necks, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. See, look, so these guys not only help Paul, but other churches. Likewise, greet the church that is in their house. So they played their part. Salute my well-beloved Epaphroditus, who is the first fruits of our care unto Christ. Greet Mary, who bestowed much labor on us. Salute Andronicus and Junia, my kinsmen, so his friends, and my fellow prisoners. So they even went to jail together, who are of note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. So Paul is saying here, see, it's not just me, there were people doing the work before me, right? Sorry, where was I up to? Greet Amplius, my beloved in the Lord. Salute Urbane, our helper in Christ, and Stachys, my beloved. Salute Apelles, approved in Christ. Salute them which are of Aristobulus' household. Salute Herodian, my kinsmen. Greet them that be of the household of Narcissus, which are in the Lord. Salute Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord. Salute the beloved Persis, which labored much in the Lord. Salute Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and mine. Salute Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermas, Patrobus, Hermes, and the brethren which are with them. Salute Philologus and Julia and Nereus and his sister and Olympus and all the saints which are with them. Salute one another with an holy kiss. The churches of Christ salute you. So we're seeing here that, you know, we're getting this idea that Rome was a successful church there, because look at all the people that were involved. And then we go down to verse 21 and we see all the people that are involved on Paul's side. To Timotheus, my work fellow, and Lucius and Jason, and Sosipater, my kinsman, salute you. I, Tertius, who wrote this epistle, salute you in the Lord. So look, Paul didn't even write some of his own letters. He had people help him do that. Gaius, mine host, and of the whole church, saluteth you. Erastus, the chamberlain of the city, salute you. And Quartus, my brother. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. So there was a lot of people involved in the church at Rome. And there was a lot of people involved in the work of Paul. But often we just attribute it to the one person, but we have to realize we all play a part and we all work together to make these great things happen. So, you know, often people get the frame of mind, and just going back to the serve and the service, but sometimes people will say things like, hey, you know, it'd be great if our church did this. Oh, it'd be great if our church did that. And, you know, my answer to that is, yeah, it would be great if our church did that. You know, as long as it lines up with our goals and our objectives here. But often when people say things like that, they say that what they mean by that is it would be great if somebody else did that. You know, it would be great if our church did that, but not me, like somebody else does that. But we have to realize we are the church. You know, and the reason why our church doesn't do things is because nobody in our church is doing it. It's not just, you know, it's not just magically the church does something. I mean, the reason why things happen in church is because I'm organizing it. But you know, if we have other ideas of what we can do, don't let me limit you. Come talk to me about it. If it's something that is aligned with our church's goals and objectives, hey, that's something we can do. And then you can run that project and hey, I'll get behind you and I'll promote it from the pulpit and you know, you'll have my blessings on it. But you just can't expect me to do everything just because I'm only one person and I'm already organizing so many things. I can only stretch myself so thin. So, I mean, one great thing that we're going to be doing soon is, you know, Brother Kevin, he's going to be running like a homeschool like talk. So I don't know what's going to become of that. But yeah, that's great. You know, like he sees a need in the church. It's aligned with our goals and our objectives. And it's something that he takes on board and takes ownership and makes it happen. So if you have something that you'd like to make happen, then come talk to me about it and we can make it happen. So as long as it aligns with our goals and principles. So obviously, you know, we're not going to, if you have an idea to have like a kids church, we're not going to do that. Or like a kids bus ministry or something like that. But you know, you can talk to me about it. That's still fine. I'm not going to be hard on you about it. I'll just say no. So let's just turn to one other passage and I'll just say a couple other things. Okay, so it's how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. And I think we see all these elements in Acts 2 when it talks about here in the early church. It says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. So there's the truth. And fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers, and fear came upon every soul. So I guess there's that ground of truth, right? That atmosphere to provoke unto love and good works. And many signs and wonders were done by the apostles. So there's the good works and the example that they're setting. And all that believed were together and had all things common. So isn't that like a family? You know, because in a family you have all things common. And sold their possessions and good and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. So we see in there the godly atmosphere. We see the family. We see the pillar of truth, the ground of truth, and the good works, the praying, that the apostles were a good example, the loving one another materialistically, helping one another. So with all that in mind, and we talked about the purpose of church, the last thing I just want to talk about is, well, if that's what a church should be, so that's what we should look for in a church, if we're looking for a church. And I just wanted to say, you know, what I look for a church, and it's very common with, you know, I guess Stephen Anderson and the David Berzins and all them that teach what we should look for in a church. But I just wanted to add a couple of my thoughts to it. So number one, you know, what to look for a church. If it's a pillar and ground of the truth, they need to have the truth, right? So they need to be preaching the right gospel. I personally would never go to a church that has the wrong gospel. So even if everything else is great, you know, maybe they're using the King James Bible, maybe they have good fellowship, I've got friends there. If they do not have the right gospel, I would not want to be there because they may not even be saved. And what am I going to learn from somebody that doesn't even know what salvation is? I mean, you don't even know what salvation is. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You're going to teach me the rest of the Bible? That's like the foundation. You know, the Bible says the foundation can no man lay, which is Jesus Christ. If they don't have the gospel right, I would not go to that church. Another thing I would look for is they need to have the Word of God. So they need to be using the King James Bible. But, you know, to be honest, I would put the gospel in priority over the King James Bible. Because in Mexico, we went to a Spanish-speaking church that did not use a Bible that was based on the King James Bible. Because all the churches that we, because we went there to go to a church that had the right Bible, but they were preaching repent of your sins. So we decided to move church and we had to decide, okay, do I go to a church that has the right Bible with the wrong gospel? Or do we try and find a church that has the right gospel, but not the right Bible? Well, I decided that to add a priority that it was more important to go to a church that had the right gospel than the right Bible. Because in the church that had the wrong gospel with the right Bible, I couldn't even go soul winning with them. Because I go soul winning with somebody and they're preaching, repent of your sins, turn from your sins, and blah, blah, blah. And you know, we're saying that it's not repent of your sins. So how do I work together with this guy I'm going soul winning with when we're not even preaching the right gospel? So we just stopped going soul winning to that church with that church, and we started looking for another church because we wanted to go to a church where we can at least get involved in the soul winning. So we went to this church that was using one that is like the NIV, it's the 1960, but they had the right gospel. I mean, ideally you'd have both, but I'm just showing you my sort of way of deciding which church I would go to. I would prioritize the gospel, because number one, then you'd know they're saved, and number two, you can get involved in the work there and preach the same gospel, even though, you know, you can still use the King James Bible. So it'd be great that they have the King James Bible, they have the correct gospel. You know, it has to be the pillar and ground of truth. So look for a church that has a godly environment. I wouldn't go to a worldly, fornication filled materialistic, homosexual filled church, because I want an environment that is conducive to raise my family in. Now, a couple of other things that I look for in a church where I wouldn't go there if it was me. Number one is where children are forced to be separated. So I would not go to a church where they would not allow my children to be in the gathering. They may have kids' church, they may have kids' ministries and stuff like that, but I would make sure if I was going to that church, you know, is it okay if my children sit with me? And, you know, I'm not against, you know, the kids' church and everything like that, but if they are forcing you to put your kids in another room, I mean, I personally wouldn't go there because it's important to me for my children to be in the church gathering. And the other thing, because soul winning is a big thing, even though a church doesn't have soul winning, I would still go there, but as long as that church is not anti-soul winning. You know, like if you're trying to go door knocking or trying to get something and they're stopping you from doing it or they are against it, I wouldn't go to that church because it's just going to kill your fire. And, you know, it's probably not a good place to be if they are trying to stop people from going out and preaching the gospel. So those are the things I definitely look for in a church. I mean, some nice to haves are the fact that they might have an organized soul winning program, that they might have all the right doctrines that we or that I attain to. But, you know, things like, you know, end times seems to be like a sticking point for some people where they will leave a church based on end times. But, you know, that's not something I would leave a church over. It's not something that I necessarily find important when going to a church, because, you know, I mean, if you find it like here, hey, that's great, then move and get to that church. But I wouldn't just be out of church just because a church, you know, preached something that had nothing to do with salvation, even though they were wrong on the tribulation and the rapture. So, you know, another thing I think is a nice to have is a leader or a bishop or a pastor that you can look up to. Because I think that's really going to affect how you grow in that church, is if you're in a church and you can't really respect the bishop, or because when you don't respect him, when he's preaching things, you're not going to absorb it. You're going to have that frame of mind of that you're trying to resist it. And I've been in that situation where you don't really respect the person that's preaching, and you don't receive what they say. It just helps you. It's nice if you have somebody that you can look up to, that you can respect. Then I think you will grow a lot more, and you can follow their example. You know, you don't feel like you're constantly clashing with the example that's being set in church. But what are a couple of reasons? What are a couple of reasons to leave a church? You know, number one is maybe you're moving, but there's an equally good church in that area. That might be a reason to move if you need to move for work or whatever like that. But you need to make sure that there is an equally good church in that area that you can be a part of that has all the things that we've talked about. You know, a reason you might want to leave a church is for doctrinal differences. I mean, maybe you don't agree with them doctrinally. I think that's a good reason to leave a church. If there's a church that is more aligned with your doctrine, hey, you know, you have my blessing. You know, go to that church that is more aligned with what you believe, because you're going to grow a lot better in that church. You know, there might be a preference or conviction. So you might have two churches that, hey, are right on salvation, both right on the King James and all the fundamental doctrines right. But, you know, that church actually is more closely aligned to your preferences. Maybe their dress standard is more aligned to your dress standard, and you might want to move to that church for that reason. I think that's an okay reason to move churches, but not a good reason to be out of church. And I was in that situation once. You know, when I was moving back to Australia, you know, we were looking at a church in Perth, and we were looking at Lighthouse Baptist Church. And they were both soul-winning, had the right gospel, King James only. But the church in Perth had a position where they just believed that the King James Bible was just the best translation in English and not actually perfect. Whereas Mark Tossell believed it was perfect. And it was for that reason that I decided to move to Sydney and settle here instead of settling in Perth. But if somebody's in Perth, we still go to that church. When we're in Perth, we go to that church because it's still a good church. You know, they have soul winning, they're preaching the right gospel, and you know, I really love the bishop there. He's a really good godly man. Doctrinal differences, preference or conviction, or an unqualified bishop. That's a reason to leave a church. Let's say the bishop is committing adultery or married several times, or you know, is not the example that you see in the Bible. I think that's a decent reason to leave a church and go to another. But lastly, what are some bad reasons to leave a church? Because often people leave churches for these reasons, but it is a terrible reason to leave a church. Number one is personal conflicts. You know, I think this is the number one reason people in our circle leave church, because they conflict with another person and then they go find another church to go to. You know, personal conflict is a really bad reason to leave a church, because personal conflicts are inevitable. You know, if you spend enough time with people, you're going to rob me the wrong way, I'm going to rob you the wrong way. So it's inevitable. So if you're leaving a church because of personal conflict, I mean, you're just going to meet it again at the next church you go to. But number two, you know, you got to look at conflict a bit differently. You know, conflict is not a bad thing in and of itself, because it's a chance for you to grow. But if you keep running away from that conflict, you know, you're not growing in that area you may need to grow, and that is dealing in your personal relationships and how to deal with conflict. And if you have a conflict with somebody, having the spiritual maturity to go to them and try and make it right, or to meet with them and talk about it, that's part of growing up the Christian life. So think of it as a chance to grow closer. And, you know, number two, you should never run from your problems. You know, you should learn to face them. So, you know, I think that's a bad reason to leave the church. That's usually the only bad reason. I mean, another reason you might want to leave the church, I don't know whether it's a good or bad reason, but maybe how they use the finances. But I suppose you can keep going to that church and maybe just not give to it if you're not supporting how they use the money.